Hello and warm welcome to EPG Pathshala. And this is Professor Srinivas Reddy, a retired professor of public administration, Kakti University, Warangal, Telangana state. Today we are going to know about a very fascinating thinker on public administration as well as on management, namely George Elton Mayo. George Elton Mayo is popularly known as the father of human relations movement. This is a big intellectual movement that has come up to perceive organization and management in a different light. For this, let me just mention that in the sequence of birth of ideas, in public administration, the first major theory of public administration is called classical theory, which held that man is basically economic, and it gave importance to formal organization. It believed that proper structure of organization is important. Organization can function well, efficiently and economically if it follows certain principles. This is the essence of classical theory. Now, this theory was considered to be limited in the sense that basically administration is a human activity. And there is no mention in classical theory about human beings, their motivation, the communication, behavioral aspects and all that. This deficiency is covered by the later contributors, including George Elton Mayo. George Elton Mayo's contribution is to human relations theory. In a larger perspective, this is also known as the neoclassical theory. Let me therefore make a contrast between what is the classical theory and what is neoclassical theory. The classical theory assumed that the administrative man is the concept of average human being found in any administrative organization. What is his nature? The classical theory says that man is selfish, he wants economic gain, and he would work. I think if you give some incentives, he will work, and the superiors can give proper direction and give proper communication, and the subordinates will follow what all is expected of them, and the organization will perform. There is another theory which is known as behavioral theory. Behavioral theory says that man is not a rational animal. They see the social side of the man. So man is basically social, and people do work, do many things for social compulsions, as fathers, as tribal chiefs, or caste elders, or community leaders. There are people who are investing their private time and effort for the benefit of somebody. It's not for their own personal gratification they are doing things. So there is a social side of the man and economic side of man. George Elton Mayo's contribution is a contribution to this transitional phase, where earlier it was believed that man is basically economic. Later it was believed man is basically social. Now in between, he said, through his experiments and all that, he demonstrated that man is both economic and social. So therefore, this theory is called neoclassical theory. This is the broad background relating to George Elton Mayo. We go to more detailed presentation of George Elton Mayo in terms of his brief biodata, his major works, and next his experiments, which have become world famous. I think in the history of industrial organizations, Hawthorne experiments were the biggest. At some point of time, it involved experiments relating to 20,000 people. I think it's a very big number. I think ever since then, perhaps no research study could cover so many individuals. Elton Mayo has made very significant contribution to Hawthorne experiments. So we study about that. And now we also see what are the major contributions of Mayo, his seminal ideas, and finally we come to some critical appraisal of George Elton Mayo. Coming to his biodata, Mayo was born in the year 1880 and died in the year 1949. He studied sociology and psychology. He was born in Austria. He worked as chairman of the Department of Philosophy at the University of Queensland in Australia. He also worked at the world-renowned Harvard University in USA, from where he came to conduct these Hawthorne experiments, which brought a lot of limelight to Elton Mayo. He has conducted a series of studies at the Hawthorne plant of the Western Electric Company. He is credited as the founder of the Human Relations School, also, as I mentioned, known as the Neoclassical School. His studies, of course, the Hawthorne experiments were long drawn out experiments, starting with fewer workers and ended, snowballed into a study of 20,000 workers. This happened from the year 1924 to 1932. But Hawthorne experiments were divided into two phases. The first phase experiments were conducted by the National Research Council, which initiated these studies. And this National Research Council study spanning from 1924 to 27 could not really come out with solutions for the problems. And the problem at Hawthorne plant of the Western Electric Company was heavy attrition of workers. Let me, for the benefit of students, explain what attrition is. Attrition is a number of people leaving jobs for number appointed. Say, for example, 100 people join a company or organization, out of which 90 leave, there is a heavy attrition. So many people are leaving, and this is a problematic. It's problematic because every year you find new people and you have to train them and put them on work, and they'll commit mistakes. So as it is known, people learn by committing mistakes, trial and error. So this is a very costly thing and organization would suffer. So this was the problem with which the National Research Council tried to see why, after all, these people were leaving. In fact, Hawthorne plant of the Western Electric Company was known for some good employment practices, pro-worker policies and all. In spite of all that, people were not staying put and they were leaving jobs, and they were all confused as to why this is happening. And this National Research Council perhaps could not give much, shed much light on the real problem. And therefore, George Elton Mayo was invited from Harvard University. He has conducted experiments with the help with his associates, Rothlis, Berger and Dixon. And the experiments continued from 1927 to 1932. And his studies, as I've already mentioned, is one of the largest studies on industrial workers anywhere in the world. Coming to the contributions of Elton Mayo, three of his books are great contributions to the problems of industry. And the first of them is titled as The Human Problems of Industrial Civilization, which was published in the year 1933. The second major book was The Social Problems of Industrial Civilization. And the third book was about, this was published in 1945. And the third book was published in 1947 with the title, The Political Problems of Industrial Civilization. By taking a look at the titles, very titles of these books, it's indicative that he has studied the industry from differing perspectives, from the human side, from the social side, from the political side, and not merely from the technical standpoint as it was done by the classical thinkers. So therefore, it could meet with larger success and come out with some new findings. Now we come to some details about the Hawthorne studies. Hawthorne studies were done in four different phases. The first phase experiment is known as the illumination experiment. Sometimes it is also known as the great illumination experiment. The second phase of study is a relay assembly test room experiment. And the third is interviewing program. And the fourth and the last is bank wiring experiment. The first of them, namely the illumination experiment, mentioned. In fact, in this experiment, they tried to see, taking a cue from the classical theory. Classical theory believed that physiology of the work is very important. Physical aspects of work are very important. The economic side of the man is very important. Just to test some of these ideas, the experiment that was done, involved varying the intensity of lighting in industrial operations. It was presumed that greater intensity of light and better light would result in greater productivity. The workers were divided into two groups. One group was called experimental group and the other one was known as control group. Experimental group was one which was made to work with the altering conditions. The control group was one, they were allowed to work under the same old conditions without any change. So there was control over the old environment was preserved, and for the reasons of comparison, the idea was to measure the productivity of these two groups. A group of workers who have been working the way they were working earlier, another group working under altering conditions. Now, the real alteration was in terms of increasing the lighting intensity, and they went on checking the records of production, and they found that they found some significant improvement in the productivity. And they tried to reverse that. Reverse in the sense they went on decreasing the light intensity, and the light intensity was brought down to moonlight level. Moonlight level is a very faint light, as if we stand in the moon. You cannot read, small letters or, complicated texts. It's very difficult, maybe broad prints and all that, perhaps you can see. So the moonlight is one where the intensity is low. But contrary to that, it was assumed that when the productivity is increasing on account of better lighting, productivity should also come down if the lighting is inferior, but this did not happen. So therefore, they concluded that light is not responsible, the physical conditions of work, change in physical conditions of work has not had impact on productivity. Productivity was on account of something else, and they were not able to see what exactly it was. The major outcome of relay assembly test room was the realization that there was a great connection between informal relations and worker satisfaction. Workers were more satisfied when informal relations were there in the organization. Now let me just make a mention as to what informal relations are. There are two types of relations people at workplace will have. Maybe some of you are working would realize that you have two types of relations with your colleagues. One relation is official relation. People working in the same workplace, somebody is a boss, somebody is a subordinate, somebody is a colleague. These are the kind of relations. But there are other kinds of relations. You may call them friendly relations, shared interests. You're all, you are fans of a particular matinee idol. You are interested in movies, you want to discuss. You are a cricket fan and you want to discuss about what has happened in the recent test match between our country and some other country. So some shared interest, some commonality of interest draws you together and you develop some relations. These relations are informal relations. Now it was found that the informal relation, when there was scope for informal relation increased, workers were more satisfied. Mere formal relations, all the time talking in terms of boss, subordinate, orders and targets and all that is a stifling. Is a kind of situation where the worker feels frustrated and he gets bored. So if you have some dash of informality, something informal in the organization, I think the worker's mood gets enlivened and he would tend to be a more satisfied worker. This link was established during this experiment. Third important experiment was interviewing program. Interviewing program was the Harvard group. Which was involved in Hawthorne studies, went and interviewed the workers, talking about their problem, their suggestions and all that. And they went on noting down the points made, suggestions made and all that. And nothing seriously was done to implement the suggestions given by workers. But in spite of that, the productivity increased. So the surmise or the conclusion that was arrived is that this is what is known as ventilation therapy. Now, when you stop your windows, you feel suffocated. When you open the windows, you feel, some fresh, whiff of fresh air comes and you feel relaxed and happy. So the workers also felt similarly when they were heard, somebody was listening to them, they felt lightened, they felt happy, and there was an impact on production. Productivity rose when they were heard. So this came to the led to a pointer that if workers are heard, workers' feelings are heard, workers' opinions are taken, workers feel better and feel more involved. This is one more thing. We come to the last of these experiments, namely bank wiring experiment. It has proved that in an organization, workers, we generally expect employees to go by rules, regulations, orders and targets. But the Hawthorne experiments proved that what officers, bosses are giving orders, these orders were not so much meeting with compliance as the group norms were meeting with. Now, in this particular experiment, incentive system was introduced. Earlier, workers were paid uniform rates of wages, but now they have introduced a new wage system wherein more the work, more the incentive. So workers went on competing and producing more and more. At some point of time, they all all peaked. The productivity went up and up and up, and at some point of time it was neither going up or coming down, it was staying put. So it peaked, or it stopped at some point of time, it was not coming down. And the researchers were curious as to know why. No, it was going up. Why at some point of time it has stopped? It was neither coming down nor going up. So they discovered that some group norms were there. The workers had a discussion about amongst themselves that now this incentive experiment is good. Some of us are able to get more salary. But how about some of the poor links, maybe the poor workers, slow workers and all that? They're all, after all, our brethren, and maybe if your people are able to manufacture, produce all the required product, so then some of them will become surplus and they will be losing their jobs. They may be fired out of the company. So this thought made them that, we are all one. We are all co-workers, and let us think about our collective interest. Maybe that management may play the weak workers against the strong workers, and we'll be divided and we'll have a problem. So therefore, they all decided that let us all produce up to this point only. And they developed some informal codes, and they would bring a group pressure to ensure that everybody performs more than earlier, but not more than that. And everybody does not madly compete with each other and keep on incessantly pushing up their productivity and all that. There will be some danger. Therefore, some group norms, like if somebody was working too fast, he was criticized and heckled as rate buster. So this guy is going to, break the rates, and we will get some less money. And somebody who was too slow was criticized as a chiseler. Chiseling is sculpting a stone sculpture. One has to be extremely careful to chisel out a nose, to get all the fine features of a nose. Maybe the shilpi or the sculptor has to spend endless time slowly, chipping off and then polishing and doing all that. So this kind of work, if somebody does, he was heckled as a chiseler. So all in all, what they were trying to do is that they were trying to bring everybody round to some group norms, and this was holding sway. So workers were following their own collective group norms rather than the orders of the superior. This was another point they found. Well, these are all the important phases of the Hawthorne studies. Now, as a result of Hawthorne studies, certain important revelations have come to the field of management and administration. One of them, as Elton Mayo has himself gave the slogan, the happy worker is the most productive worker. What it says is that if you make worker happy, he will end up being a very productive worker. So in the worker's happiness lies the happiness of the company. So he was making the proposition that the organization has to pay attention to making the worker happy, and in the happiness of the worker lies the happiness of the company. The second important point made by Hawthorne experiments and Elton Mayo's work is that the power of informal organization. Now, far too long we were thinking that formal organization, official relations are very important, but informal organization is inevitable. In every organization, there are some friendly informal relations, and they are very powerful. And no management can ever forestall all the relations. And it is useful to allow them to flourish. And these informal relations are important because they give satisfaction to worker. And they drive the monotony from workplace, and they ensure creativity. The workers may turn out to be more creative if there is some informality, instead of all the time feeling jettisoned, working in the company of the boss, standing up every time the boss coming, and paying attention to the boss. You are not yourself. This alienates a person. So you'll be yourself when you have this informality, and that is brought out. And one more point brought out in conclusion to mention is the importance of norms. Now, it's not only the rules, regulations that are important, norms are also important. Norms are the collective thinking, the collective ideas of people. And although it may not be there in a rule book, but these norms will be more followed, more implicitly followed by the employees than the rules framed by the organization. And finally, there is one more thing called Hawthorne effect. What it means is, Elton Mayo said that the human behavior is of two kinds. When somebody is noticed, somebody is observing what one is doing, one tends to be very cautious, and one's behavior is going to be something which is different when one is not watched. Now, if you are all alone, maybe this example would be that of a bathroom singing. I think the most people tend to be singers in the bathroom. No, they would be singing something, and the moment somebody overhears and says, "Oh, guy, you are singing some song," the fellow will stop. So he would not like to sing before others. So this is something private behavior. So in public you behave. I think maybe similarly, if you find some gold ornament on the road, when others are watching you, you will pick it up and try to appear very honest and looking for the owner of the gold ornament. And if nobody is looking around and you are in absolute privacy, you are likely to, you know, pocket it and go off scot-free, not to be seen by anybody. Quickly you disappear from the scene and all that. This kind of change in behavior. So we are the same person, but we are something in privacy, and we are something different in public. So this is what is known as Hawthorne behavior. Behavior changes when you are in the company of others. And in fact, the whole lot of human relations theory has some connectivity with this kind of proposition also. There are two important criticisms leveled against George Elton Mayo, and one of them is that he is credited as the father of industrial sociology. He has tried to tell us the social dynamics of an industrial organization. He was of the view that industry is a microcosm of the society. What's happening in the wider society is also happening there. The same relations. Maybe if you, bring an example nearer home, I think when we work in the office, we tend to, not to forget entirely about our caste background, our gender background, our class background, our regional background. I think somewhere we throw hints of this and act on the basis of these things. So these are all informal considerations, and therefore all these things are important to understand. And Elton Mayo has tried to pay attention to industrial sociology, and he is credited as the father of industrial sociology. A lot of contributions were made later, and the early lead was given by Elton Mayo to the subject or discipline of industrial sociology. Of course, one criticism that he perhaps is faulted is his sociology, this industrial sociology, that is the point I am trying to connect, is a kind of cow sociology. A cow sociology is a thing which assumes human being to be like a cow. I think all of us know cow is a domesticated animal. The bull is not a domesticated, the bull is more aggressive than cow. So cow sociology is that cow is a very sane animal, very innocent animal, and domesticated animal, and we all offer puja. I think in Hindu mythology it has a big place, and cow is a revered symbol. Similarly, this man has assumed everybody to be like a cow. Everybody is a sadhu and all that. Therefore, he said that to bring in industrial production, strict supervision may be needed. Maybe the bosses need to bulldoze the subordinates when they are not listening, they are not following the orders properly. So his interpretation of society as cow sociology, or everybody is soft and good and all that, is not entirely the portrayal of the reality of human nature. There are some people who are not like cows. They're different, and therefore he has not taken care of that. And he has also seen the human nature in a positive light. He believed human beings to be trustworthy and believable and all that. And this is another side. People say that, you know, all people are not dependable. All people are not reliable. There are some unreliable people. And all people will not be reliable all the time. You know, human nature also has a dynamic element. So these are some points of criticism. These points of criticism notwithstanding, George Elton Mayo is credited to be a major thinker who has made very significant contributions to both management theory and administration theory. And his most important contribution is to human relations, the impact, importance of human relations, making employees happy, and understanding organizations from the social perspective, and the significance of group norms and inescapability of group norms. These are some of the points on which he has educated the managers and the students of management and public admin. Therefore, he has an important place in the unfolding of ideas on management and administration, and by implication perhaps to public administration. One has to mention that his studies, perhaps this can also remain a point of criticism, his studies were done in the context of a private industry. The nature of workers in the context of a private industry, can we really generalize these two public organizations? So this is a arguable point. Maybe that there is something universal about human nature. You know, whether you work in a private organization or a public organization, there are some people who are basically good. They work well in private organization as well as public organization. So one can come back and make a different position and defend or, you know, criticize him. But the point is that all his studies relate to industrial settings, manufacturing sector, basically. Nowadays, the industry is also changing. GDP, India's GDP contribution is largely coming from the service sector, more than 60%, not from manufacturing sector. So can we generalize the human nature that is captured in the setting of a private industry to government and non-manufacturing sectors is a question to be answered. So thank you. This is, you know, something about the ideas of George Elton Mayo, who is considered the father of human relations theory, and also a prominent contributor to neoclassical theory of administration. Thank you.